Institute is equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. You can be better informed, more motivated, and more effective. Subscribe to our fact-filled newsletter, participate in our book clubs, attend a workshop, and of course, you're tuned into our podcasts. Dr. J is once again a guest on Janet Mefford's radio show to discuss the state of Alabama's recent moves to eliminate marriage licenses and privatize marriage. Their Senate has passed a motion to handle marriages through affidavits between adults.
Thank you so much for joining us again. Well, as we told you recently, the state of Alabama is well on its way toward eliminating marriage licenses. The Alabama Senate recently passed a measure setting up a process under which probate judges accept affidavits from couples as official records of marriage. And as AL.com reported, the requirement of a ceremony to solemnize the marriage would also be eliminated. Now, the sponsor, Senator Greg Albritton, said this will take the state out of any role in marriage ceremonies and properly separate church and state. Also, solving the problem of probate judges who don't want to issue marriage licenses to same-sex couples. But could there be unintended consequences? My next guest has written about this idea that taking the state out of the marriage business will lead to a better future for everyone. So we're going to get some thoughts on this now from Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse, who is founder and president of the Ruth Institute. And Jennifer, just wonderful to have you here. Thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, well, thank you for having me, Janice. This is quite a thing, isn't it? Alabama getting out of the marriage business.
I know exactly what you've said. And by the way, I should tell people, you wrote a three-part series on the public discourse back in 2012, which people really need to read in detail because you really get this issue. What is your reaction to this? Does this alarm you, or does it seem like maybe it's an okay compromise? How do you interpret it?
Well, first of all, people want to find that three-part series that I did. We sell it at the Ruth Institute now, so people could go to ruthinstitute.org and go to our store, and we call it the government's duty to marriage.
Great.
Okay, the government has a duty to marriage, and that duty is to say that these two people are the parents of this child, and nobody else is. You know, that's the long and short of it, that the institution of marriage is something that should be there for the state to do justice to children and parents.
Yes.
That's what it should be all about. And so this thing that Alabama has done, you know, Janet, I can't quite figure it out because I can't figure out what it's going to mean for the definition of parenthood.
Yeah.
You see, that has always been my concern with this issue. I don't really care that much about licenses and, you know, and ceremonies and stuff per se. That's not my concern. My concern is that marriage has been traditionally the thing that connects children to their parents so that everybody can know this man, this woman, they are the parents of this child. I have no idea what this is going to mean for the establishment of parental rights. I haven't seen anybody say what they think it's going to mean. So I don't know. Have you seen anything about this?
No.
That story you sent me, that's it.
That's why we called you. Because I said, if anybody's going to know, Jennifer Roback-Morse is going to know. I had the exact same reaction, though. It's so funny that you said that, because I read that and I was talking to some friends of mine who are very much on the LGBT issues. And I said, this has a possibility of going the wrong direction when I've heard all these gay activists over the years saying the state should just get out of the marriage business. We want to just get rid of marriage. And I thought there's got to be some connection here. But when you read the story, this state senator says, well, this is a way to separate church and state and not have to violate the consciences of these probate judges. But I do wonder what sort of unintended consequences might come of it.
Yes, you know, he sounds like, and I have heard this argument from religious people before, you know, saying that this is the way to, you know, leave it to the church. You know, that a person's going to be validly married if their church says they're validly married. Well, that's not really much of an answer when there are legal implications of marriage. I forget the exact word, but there are legal implications for marriage that have to do with property, that have to do with custody if there's a separation and you're trying to figure out who's going to be in charge of the children and that kind of thing. You know, so the state is never going to leave the church alone to do whatever the church thinks is the right thing to do about marriage. You know, so that idea, you know, if that's your idea that, you know, okay, you know, now marriage is all belongs to the church now, and we just have this funny little probate procedure, and that's the whole involvement of the state. that's very naive. You know, if that's what they think they're doing, that's very naive. Because if the relationship breaks down, what do we even call it? It's not a marriage, right? If the couple decides they don't want to be together anymore, you can be sure that they're not just going to go down to their pastor and whatever Pastor Joe says, that's what's going to happen.
Yeah,
you know, that's not how it's going to go, you know.
No.
The court's going to get involved. Family court's going to be involved. There might be DNA testing to figure out if the guy's really the father. You know, the state will not leave this alone completely. And that, if that's the hope, that's a naive hope.
No, I agree. And one of the things that you've said is that marriage is society's primary institutional arrangement that defines parenthood. And so marriage has a social public function. In other words, you can't ultimately privatize marriage, can you?
That's exactly right. You know, so they're going to rename that function. Let's see. I mean, that's really, in a sense, what they're doing is they're renaming that function. But if I could use this $10 word here, they're deinstitutionalizing that function.
Yeah.
So instead of there being, just a few kind of bright line rules that say these are the parents of the child, now you're going to be doing case by case stuff. You know, so the traditional method, just to review, the traditional method was when a baby is born, the woman who gives birth to the baby is presumed to be the child's mother.
Yes.
Right. That used to be 100% bulletproof, brain dead conception. But now that we have surrogacy, it isn't anymore. But set aside surrogacy for a moment. When the woman gives birth to the baby, she's legally presumed to be the child's mother. And then the question is, who's the father? Well, if the woman is married, when you have an establishment or an institution that says, we have a lifelong union of a man and a woman and a sexually exclusive union of a man and a woman, then you presume that her husband is the father of any children she gives birth to.
Right.
And that's the way the law worked. That was called the presumption of paternity, and it had the effect of attaching children to their biological parents and, incidentally, excluding every other possible person from having a legal claim to be the child's parent, which is a good thing, right?
Yes.
attaching children to their parents and minimizing headaches and uncertainty and quarrels and that kind of thing. So now, if you don't have an institution like that, how are you going to know who's the father? How are you going to know who has legal responsibility for that child? And I suppose what you're going to have to do is to say the woman is going to name the guy on the birth certificate, which that already, in the case of unmarried parenthood, that already is how it's done, I think. She names the guy. Well, maybe he's not around. Maybe he doesn't want to be named. Maybe he thinks it isn't really his kid, you know?
Yeah.
So then there has to be a backup plan, which is you go do a paternity test and you find out if it really is him. So by taking away that legal structure of marriage, you're not going to solve the problem of who counts as the child parent. You're going to have to solve that problem some other way.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And if the father is a guy who is, for whatever reason, not particularly committed to this woman, he's not going to just voluntarily pay a child support just out of the goodness of his heart. He's going to have to be compelled.
Yeah.
You know, the state's going to have to be involved in making him pay and extracting resources and all that kind of thing. And you didn't have to do that in a marriage. In a marriage, the husband and wife, mother and father, have already agreed
Yes.
that they're going to live together and share resources and build a home together and build a life together. And yes, there are sometimes problems, but those problems are nothing compared with the kind of problems that we're setting ourselves up for under this type of arrangement. So that's what I would say is the concern. That's my concern. And I haven't seen anybody in Alabama explain how they're going to solve that.
I know.
So I don't know, Janet.
I don't know either. I don't know how it's going to come down, but I just keep looking at it and saying this. I just don't think this is going to end well, especially if this becomes a new thing. And that's always the concern, that once one state goes in that direction, other states say, oh, this will solve our problem. And I'm not convinced that it will.
No, I'm convinced that it won't solve the problem. I mean, it's going to cascade into other areas that I don't think people have thought through yet. That's really the issue, you know, that the first time somebody comes into court with a dispute or a question, then they'll have to answer this question.
Check out at ruthinstitute.org, The Government's Duty to Marriage. You really have to read what Jennifer has written on this subject of privatizing marriage and why it's not a good idea. And the news story that is triggering all of this is the state of Alabama, the Senate at least, has passed this measure setting up a process where they are eliminating marriage licenses. And this is supposed to solve the problem of probate judges who don't want to issue licenses to same-sex couples. But could there be unintended consequences? My question to Jennifer is, if you get out the state out of the business of issuing marriage licenses, how can you continue to define marriage? I mean, is there any problem there where they'll begin to lose more in the way of saying you can do this but not that? Or would that accelerate the slippery slope?
Well, I think they believe that by not issuing marriage licenses, that's what they've done, that they're becoming neutral with respect to different types of relationships. I think that's what they are attempting to do here. And so I'm guessing that what's going to happen as a practical matter is that whatever procedures they have in place now for children of unmarried parents, those procedures, whether you call that a common law marriage or common law union or whatever those procedures are, I'm guessing that's what's going to be applied to everything.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the question is there any problem with that? Well, my only point about that, first point is, so all the problems you were worried about reappear in that new forum, right? So if the person is not the child's biological other parent, but you don't want to have a relationship with the child's other biological parent, you still have to make some decisions about who you're going to count as the legal parent of the child.
Right.
And you are going to privilege, so-called privilege, use that term privilege, you are going to privilege some relationships over others because the state is going to say, yes, this person counts as a parent, no, that person doesn't count. You know, so they're sure. going to end up making some kind of judgments, you know, and the LGBT advocates do not want biology.
No.
To be the sole determinant of parenthood or even the main determinant of parenthood. I mean, if you read some of the radicals, Janet, they think biology is way, way overrated.
Yes.
You know, and so they want to break down the connection in people's mind between biology and legal parenthood. So is this going to help that? Is this going to hurt that? This particular thing that the state of Alabama is doing, they're still going to have to deal with it. That's my point. They're still going to have to answer that question. What does the state of Alabama think about parentage?
Yeah.
Who counts as a parent in the state of Alabama? They're still going to have to answer that question. And they're not going to say anybody who shows up and says they're a parent gets to be a parent.
No.
That's not going to be the rule.
Right.
That's not going to be the rule, I guarantee you, you know.
Yeah, you're so right about it. But one of the things that happens, and this is going back to something you said before the break, when you say that the state, in the attempt to privatize marriage, ends up getting more power, actually, on the other end. Mm-hmm. One of the things you cite is no-fault divorce. So they thought at the time, you get rid of, you know, these standards for getting a divorce. We're going to allow people to get divorced for any reason. And that'll simplify things and that'll make us more neutral. It actually made things worse on the back end. Can you explain what that's about, why that is?
Yes. Yes, that's exactly right. I mean, what happened with divorce is that, to use the language you just used there, you're more free on the front end when you enter into divorce, but you're way less free on the back end because the state ends up coming back into the process. They say, oh, you can get divorced for any reason you want. But the fact is that most divorces do not take place by the mutual agreement of the parties. That's a complete myth. Probably at least 70% of divorces take place against the wishes of one party.
Wow.
So that means if you're going to have so-called no-fault divorce, it's really unilateral divorce. The government has to enforce that divorce. They have to separate somebody from the assets of the family, usually the family home and the children, right? The state has to enforce that. That person doesn't want to move out. They don't want to give up seeing their kids.
Yeah.
But the government is involved in that. And they become involved. They can become involved. And your listeners will recognize this, I'm sure. The government can end up being involved in literally every aspect of the family's life.
Yeah.
You know, they're telling you how much money you have to spend, how much money the non-custodial parent, usually the father, has to send to the custodial parent. They'll be adjudicating who gets to see the child and when, at what time, for how long. And things that used to be done through mutual cooperation and through love, or that could be done through love and mutual cooperation, those things are now being done by court decree.
Yeah.
And, you know, so, I mean, I tell people this are thinking about getting divorced, so I wish I should put this thought in your mind. If you think he's mean now, what do you think he's going to be like after you've put him through family court?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Is he going to be easier to deal with after that? But I mean, that takes us a little bit further afield from what we're trying to talk about here. But
it's true,
but it shows that the state, by saying you can get divorced for any reason you want, you're completely free to do whatever you want, that's a myth.
Yeah.
It's a complete myth.
Yeah.
And it's going to show up in this instance by saying, well, anybody can have any relationship they want. The government will not take sides or choose among different types of relationship. That sounds so freeing and so wonderful and so modern and hip and everything. But when it comes down to it, if you've got children, somebody has to decide who's responsible for those children.
That's it.
And you will not always get what you want. I guarantee you, you're not always going to get what you want. And for sure, the kids are not always going to get what they need. That's for sure.
Yes.
So that's the trade-off. That's the big trade-off. And people just aren't even aware that they're setting themselves up for that trade-off.
It makes total sense. The other thing that strikes me is the more that the family breaks apart, the more power the state gets. But then that should show the state why it's important to protect the family to begin with, because it's resulted in all of this chaos. I mean, you mentioned that you even have parenthood becoming the creation of the state. Now that you've got the octomoms of the world and you've got the welfare state,
right,
and the state is the de facto
right
husband who isn't around to take care of the kids. Isn't this more of a reason for the state to say, yes, we should be involved in the business of marriage, and it's between a man and a woman? Let's go back to plan A, because plan B is just ensuing in all this chaos.
Well, that depends on what the people in the government actually are trying to accomplish.
Yeah.
If they want more power for themselves, this is a great plan.
True. Oh.
Social chaos is a great plan if you're trying to maximize your power, if you're trying to come up with more reasons why the government needs more money for this program or the other program. And if you're not really happy with how these parents are taking care of their own kids, and maybe they're indoctrinating them into strange things, and maybe the government just really needs to be involved in rearing everybody's kids.
Yeah.
You know, hey, some of the people, Janet, totalitarians of every stripe, that they always want to get a grip on the family.
They do.
The family is always in their way, you know. So, I mean, I'm not accusing anybody directly, but from one perspective, it's not that surprising.
No.
That the government doesn't really mind some of the social chaos that the breakdown of the family has caused.
Yeah, it's a great point. Next thing you know, we'll be Canada, though. I mean, look what's going on in Canada with the family. Oh, we don't want to let Christian parents adopt. I mean, it's getting insane, but nothing is going to stop it from eventually coming here if the ideology is all messed up.
No, that's right, Janet. I mean, what I think is that the typical Christian person has no idea just how toxic these ideologies really are.
True.
A lot of people thought, well, gee, feminism sounds so nice. You know, we should be fair to women. We shouldn't let women do whatever job they want and get paid the same as men. That's only fair. But that isn't really what it was all about. You know, there were that was kind of the smoke screen. That was the thing that was put out front for people to look at. Behind it was the idea, we're going to make everybody equal in every way. Mm. Well, you can't really do that unless you can control everything they do.
Right.
You know, that's the little hidden message that people hope nobody looks at too closely. But the fact is, if you're going to try to make everybody be equal in every way, that means you get to control everything in every way.
That's true.
And we've let way too much go by because things sound good and we're not looking behind the slogans to see what is really going to happen.
Yes, and I don't understand, when Alabama eliminates marriage licenses, it seems to me that you don't even have to go that far. If you want to protect the consciences of the probate judges, just pass a religious freedom law like they did in Mississippi and say you don't have to issue a license if it's against your conscience. I mean, whatever happened to the First Amendment here? It's as if the First Amendment doesn't have any weight, and it ought to have tremendous weight in these cases.
Well, you know what? I don't want to hurt your feelings. I don't want to hurt Kim Davis's feelings or anything. But to me, I'm not that worried about religious freedom, Janet. Mm. I'm worried about the fact that the religious people are correct on the substance of the issue.
True.
And if the only thing we worry about is you're making me do something against my conscience, we're never going to get anywhere.
Yeah.
Because we need to make a full-throated defense of why we're right and why these innovations are wrong.
Well said.
Why they're going to hurt people, see?
I agree.
So that's why, you know, yeah, we need religious liberty, but if that's all we have to say, I think in the end we won't win that. We need to be saying substantially, on the substance of the issue, children need their parents. Therefore, we need to have some rigorous institution that defends the right of children to their parents. And here's why, you know, and that's what we need to be talking about. And what makes me kind of sad about what I've read in the Alabama case so far, what makes me sad about it is that I don't see anybody over there talking like this.
No,
you know,
I know
people. Yeah, yeah. I mean, people give lip service to kids need a mom and a dad. You know, that's lame. Kids need their own mom.
Thank
and
you.
Their own dad.
Yes, exactly. their mom and their dad who created them. Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
What
right,
a concept.
Right. Yeah, we've let so much go by. The whole divorce culture has already undermined that so much that it's hard for people to say and really have their hearts in it, you know.
I know. Well, Jennifer Roback Morris, check out RuthInstitute.org. Jennifer, thank you so much for being here.
You've just been listening to Dr. J speaking with Janet Mefford about privatizing marriage, the issues that arise related to parenthood, and overarching state involvement on her radio show, Janet Mefford Today. Check out The Government's Duty to Marriage over at our web store on ruthinstitute.org. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. Like us on Facebook, check out the site, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter to stay informed.